I woke up in a forest with no memory. A woman in a blue coat came to me and said my husband killed her sister. Then she ran away. Lo and behold, my husband Michael appeared at that moment. When he touched me, a little bit of my memory returned. I remembered my name, Michael himself, how we met, my job, theater professional, and my boss, Thomas. That night, Michael took me out to dinner. The place was full of old men with much younger partners. Halfway through the meal, one of the young women had a breakdown and begged me to save her. Michael said we don't know her. I couldn't sleep after that, so I got out of bed at 2:30 and explored the house. At some point, I noticed a necklace on the coffee table, a pendant in the shape of a bull's head. I picked it up. Next thing I knew, it was 7:30 in the morning. Michael had left for work, and there was evidence I'd eaten breakfast with him. I'd lost 5 hours. The bull pendant disappeared, replaced with a manila envelope that held 3 weird photos. One of me as a child, one of Michael as a much younger man, and a photo of Michael and the woman in the blue coat standing in my theater. Right at that moment, my husband's assistant, Richard, knocked and invited me out to lunch. After we ate, a monstrous bull-headed figure, one only I could see, started following me. Then the woman in the blue coat found me and told me some disturbing things. Before I could press her for answers, she disappeared yet again. When I got back home, I found a box filled with paperwork. It proved that everything, literally everything, Michael told me, is a lie. So I left my house, my husband's house, my soulless dollhouse, on Friday afternoon. I took my laptop. Well, I think it's mine. It was in a computer bag with my cash-filled wallet, and the documents. Because I don't know who I am, I had nowhere to go, so I went to a diner, guzzled coffee, and pored over the papers. Police reports comprised half of it. There's so much, literally hundreds of pages, but it all boils down to this. I was sexually abused and tortured as a child. They know this because they found hundreds of hours of it on tape. Evidence suggests I was about 3 years old when it started. After rescuing me, the authorities tried to find my family, but it looks like I don't have one. I was imprisoned in a compound with 17 other kids. I wasn't blood related to any of them or any of the perpetrators. I don't match any of the missing persons reports from the relevant time frame. In other words, no one ever so much as reported me as missing, let alone tried to find me. The state put me in foster care. I ran away almost immediately. Then there's nothing until my 18th birthday, when I married Michael. For the record, he's 27 years older than me. Not that you can really tell. Everything aside, he really is very good looking. Just a couple of days ago, he claimed he's only known me for 5 years, which oddly is what I remember. I remember meeting him 5 years ago at the theater where I work. The problem here is, according to my tax returns, which were bundled in with the police reports, I've never worked for a theater. A few photos are mixed in with the documentation. One is of a bland strip mall storefront. One looks like an honest-to-God castle, one is a proper white trash shack compound, and one is of a perfectly circular clearing surrounded by oaks and pines. The clearing, castle, and compound are hopeless. No names, other landmarks, or anything trackable. For all I know, they could be 20 miles away or on the other side of the world. The storefront, however, has a name. Lucky for me, it turned out to be 3 short bus rides from the diner. So I decided to brave public transit in the middle of the night. While close geographically, the shop was worlds away from the diner, let alone my white-collar dollhouse life with Michael. The area was crowded and broken down, sun-bleached to nothing by decades of light and relentless heat. Homeless people huddled together, giving wide berths to the unlucky individuals babbling to themselves. Rangy men and hard-lipped women lounged at the corners. I watched a convenience store clerk shoo a gaggle of them away. Minutes later, they drifted back, like leaves rolling in before a storm. One of them sidled up to me, barely visible in my periphery. I didn't want to look. I was afraid they'd see the fear on my face or smell the cash on me. So I stared resolutely ahead, fighting the urge to run.
"What are you doing?"
the stranger asked calmly. Not a stranger. Her again. The one who'd started this mess, who followed me everywhere and told me nothing. The woman in the blue coat. I rattled my computer bag aggressively, if you could even call a computer bag aggressive. "Did you leave this?"
"Leave what?"
100 calculated gazes bored through me as I walked. I wondered what they saw, what they thought of me. The box of papers, the police reports, the records, the... She shushed me so loudly several people turned, startled.
No,
she hissed.
I would never do that to you. Where are you going?
I picked up my pace, half hoping she'd fall behind, but the store had already come into view. The woman's gray eyes widened and she stopped.
Here?
Here. I adjusted my bag and strode forward. She tried to pull me back, but I shook her off as a lady nearby snickered.
Rachel, please, don't go in there.
Why? I snapped. What's in there? More cryptic bullshit. I wasn't impressed. The more I saw of her, the less I feared her. In fact, she was quickly becoming a pest. Ignoring her pleas, I entered the shop. It was cool and dark, devoid of people. Rows of fold-out tables lined the walls, piled with duffel bags and stacks of unmarked discs. The carpet was thin and worn through to concrete. There was an air of neglect, of tense and temporary settlement. Cheap tables and open cases made me think these people were ready to pack up and disappear at a moment's notice. The woman in the blue coat stalked in and immediately beelined for me. Before I knew it, she was clinging to my arm, whispering a panicked litany of swear words and implorations as we approached the front of the shop.
You shouldn't be here, Rachel. Rachel, please don't be here. You should go now.
I stopped at the counter. Behind it, several layers of fluttering black muslin colored a small entryway.
Fuck, Rachel, shit. This is bad. You can't handle this. You're just a lamb. You aren't supposed to know. You need to go, though. No, shit. Fuck, God fucking damn it. I can't. You can't.
A red-haired man exploded through the muslin, making me jump. The blue-coated woman's grip relaxed unexpectedly.
Get out of here,
the man snapped. Cold but impersonal. He reminded me of the clerk who'd chased the homeless people away, people who drifted right back like moths to a flame. I have money, I said.
No.
The blue-coated woman keened miserably.
Just get the fuck out, lady.
I said I have money. He eyed me up and down, sardonic and contemptuous and mildly leering.
And I said this isn't the place for you. Get out.
From behind the muslin.
What's happening out there?
A second man emerged, stooping to fit through the entryway. He was almost impossibly tall, with shorn black hair and long, narrow eyes. My companion tightened her grip on my arm again, fingertips digging painfully into soft flesh. The tall man looked at me, face tight and unhappy. Then suddenly, he smiled, wide and predatory, a Cheshire cat grin.
You fucking moron.
His tone was jolly, each syllable low and musical.
This isn't a crazy. This is our bread and butter.
I met the tall man's gaze resolutely, but oh, how my heart fell. The redhead glanced irritably between us. The man finally sighed and said,
Look at her. Look at her mouth, her hair, her eyes. Or are you that stupid?
I fidgeted as the boy glared at me. It took a good minute before the recognition finally dawned on his face. His eyes brightened and a feverish, starstruck smile touched his lips.
I'm sorry. I didn't think. Not at all unusual, I'm afraid.
The tall man gave him a contemptuous look before turning to me with a smile.
What have you come for, my dear?
You already know.
The blue-coated woman squeaked. I stared, amazed that she'd spoken. The tall man chuckled.
True, but why?
None of your fucking business.
Foul and beautiful as always. So, what shall it be?
That lazy smile spread even farther up his cheeks, carving lines that ran from eye to chin.
Your early work or later masterpieces?
All of it,
said the woman.
Indulging a streak of voyeuristic narcissism, are we?
His smile darkened slightly.
You will come back someday soon and tell me what all this is about, won't you?
Without thinking, I said, Don't I always? The man pouted playfully.
Not always.
He straightened up briskly.
Give me a few minutes.
He went into the back while the redhead picked a handful of discs from various tables. He kept glancing over his shoulder at me with a weird combination of shyness and the kind of dirty awe that made me ill. The man returned with a sizable stack of cheap hard drives. He and the redhead wrapped and bagged them in ancient, brittle grocery sacks. While they worked, the atmosphere darkened considerably. My scalp began to prickle, and strange chills ran down my spine. I could feel clammy sweat beating at my hairline. The blue-coated woman wasn't helping. She kept shifting back and forth, grip tightening and tightening on my arms. Stop it, I finally hissed. The redhead glanced up excitedly, but the tall man gave him a warning look. The blonde woman had turned to face the front of the shop, eyes so wide I could see the reflection of the door, and of a tall, golden figure. I turned slowly, steeling myself. A great fanged bull's head, bedecked in jewels, stared back at me. It was a headdress of some kind, fantastically outsized for the distinctly feminine form. Beneath it, dark, tacky blood stained her hands and trailed down her thighs. Faint darkness emanated from her, like an anti-halo, something that not only hid the light, but consumed it. "Do you see her?" I whispered.
"Who is?"
The woman in the blue coat whimpered.
"Oh."
The redhead breathed dreamily. Even the tall man looked up this time, unable to conceal his excitement. The creature in the bull's head faced me for what felt like an eternity. Then she pivoted, chained jewels clattering against the golden headdress, and exited into the night. Suddenly the tall man cleared his throat. I whirled around. He handed me a bag with a deferential smile.
"As requested? I'm sorry to ask, but..."
His shoulders slumped slightly, but it was a false gesture.
"Will compensation be forthcoming?"
"Always," I said thinly, with no idea what I had agreed to.
"Would you like anything else from me?"
His white teeth and long, glittering eyes made my skin crawl. "No, but thank you." He inclined his head respectfully.
"Then I hope to see you soon."
The blue-coated woman practically dragged me out of the shop. Drops and trails of blood stained the ragged floor, proof that the thing with the bull's head had indeed been here. Once we exited into the night, I grabbed the woman's shoulder. "What was that?" My voice sounded weak and broken. The woman in the blue coat wouldn't look at me.
"Her name is Gabrielle."
"Who is she?"
"No one you know. Someone you have to ignore, no matter what happens."
"Is she real?"
"As real as you and me."
"What is she?" The woman shrieked in frustration and spun around, jabbing violently at my face. People around us, there were so many, many more than I'd thought, reared back and gave us a berth.
"Stop talking about her!"
she screamed.
"She takes enough, don't give her more!"
The woman ran ahead, disappearing into the nighttime throng. I chased her, sidestepping beggars and drunks, taking care not to trip on the buckled concrete. I turned the corner, heart sinking. I tore my way through the crowd. It was easier than I expected. Most of them moved out of the way long before I reached them. I searched for what simultaneously felt like hours and minutes. Finally, breathless and clutching a stitch in my side, I collapsed on a bench and surveyed my surroundings. It was 3:30 in the morning. Laughing men and cat-like women clung to storefronts and strutted between prowling cars. I was trapped for the night. Trapped in an unfamiliar, dangerous place with a computer, 2,000 useless dollars, and no way out. After a while, I stood up and started walking. I thought about finding a room and finally sleeping, but the idea scared me. Both the blue-coated woman and the thing in the bull headdress had tracked me down miles away from home in the kind of area women like me shied away from. I wasn't safe. I'd be even less safe in a strange room, alone. So I kept walking. 10 minutes, an hour, I didn't know or care. At some point, I passed a police substation. I was 5 blocks past it when I realized the cops could help me. I spun around and ran. Several women laughed and a man hissed appreciatively after me. I ignored them all, keeping my eyes trained on the brilliantly lit station. Light spilled from the grimy windows like white fire from heaven. It seemed so far away, and I was so tired. But I had to do it. This was it. This was the answer. The cops. Safety lay just a few minutes away. I was so focused on the station that I didn't see the man sitting on the street, legs outstretched. The toe of my shoe caught his ankle, and I went flying, scraping my palms bloody as I skidded to a stop. I crawled to my feet, mortified, and I turned to face my victim. The force of my stride had rolled him onto his side. As I watched, he dragged himself up and used his hands to reposition his legs. Stricken, I realized he was paraplegic.
"I'm so sorry."
I ran over, already fumbling in my bag for money. I knelt at his side. His eyes traveled over my face. He looked scared, and no wonder.
I didn't mean...
He wailed loudly, deep baritone threatening to blow my eardrums. My head snapped back. He started flailing, slapping and kicking at me blindly. I skittered back, cursing myself for hurting him more.
I'm sorry,
I yelled.
I'm sorry, I'll go, I'll...
Someone rushed over to help him. I thought of his legs, wondering if I'd broken them, if I was about to go to jail. His wailing shrank to a mumbled snivel as the newcomer comforted him. It was another man. His voice was authoritative and soothing. The paralyzed man nodded, and whimpering covered his eyes. The newcomer stood to face me, His face was drawn and tired, but not unkind. I backed away nervously, but he strode forward. When he passed under a streetlight, my mouth fell open. Thomas. Thomas, the boss I remembered from my job at the theater. The job I'd never had at the theater that didn't exist. A figment of my imagination. Before me, in the flesh. I wanted to look at him, to touch him, to prove he was real. But my feet drove me backward, somehow independent of my own will. He held his hands up in a non-threatening gesture.
It's all right. He's all right. I'm all right. I just want to check on you. It's because you took a bad fall, okay?
Thomas approached faster than I could retreat, and before I knew it, he had a hand on my shoulder, soothing me the way he'd soothed the screaming man. He leaned down and inspected my hands. I couldn't look away from him. Up close, there was no question. Hollow cheeks, thin mouth, smooth hair, and above all, his eyes. Clearest light brown, just a shade away from gold. Thomas, I murmured. He gave me a keen, quizzical look.
No, but funny. You're not the first one who thinks that's my name.
I cleared my throat and straightened up, willing him to see me, to recognize me as I'd recognized him, to confirm something, anything. I think I know you. He moved back a little, body language shifting from conciliatory to smoothly eager. He gave a coy smile.
I think I'd remember you.
I backed away, confused. You'd be surprised. His eyes reflected the yellow street lamps, cat-like, almost chilling.
Either way, I wouldn't mind getting to know you.
All at once, I understood what was going on. Heat stung my eyes, threatening tears. He was a prostitute. My boss, or whoever he actually was. Don't you know me? I asked. His veneer cracked for a fraction of a second before that silky smile reappeared. Long, playful, lazy, like a Cheshire cat.
I'd like to.
Thomas, I repeated desperately. Thomas, you're my boss. You didn't like me, but then you did, or maybe not, but one night something happened. I heard you cry. I don't know what, but I don't remember anything after. You told me about my husband. You told me Michael was an original Bluebeard, and something happened. I don't know what. Do you? Do you remember any of this? The smile dropped away, leaving confusion and fear. His eyes searched mine desperately, flicking back and forth across my face. Little boy lost and a little girl lost, trying to find themselves in each other's eyes. Frown lines cut his face deeply, each one filling with horror before my eyes.
You can't be here.
He retreated, eyes growing wider by the second.
I know you can't be here.
I reached for him, not knowing what to do or say, only wanting to keep him with me. The second my fingertips brushed his skin, he reared around and slapped me. Stars rocketed across my vision. He ran to the paralyzed man, who was small. I saw, younger and so much smaller than I'd realized. Picked him up and hurried away. As he turned the corner, the streetlights dimmed and everything suddenly sounded muffled. I already knew it was coming. The long, cruel horns appeared first, followed by the snout and the fanged maw. Ropes of gemstone swayed and clinked as the bull trudged into view. The headdress looked insane, ornate and elaborate and horrifying, almost half as tall as the woman who wore it. The bull stopped when it saw me. I tried to see what lay beyond the headdress, but it was no use. It was too deep, too far, too dark. With a great lurch, it staggered toward me. I ran. The police station looked farther away than ever, but it couldn't have been. I was closer, getting closer every step. Never mind the clatter of chains and the jewels echoed behind me. Never mind, never mind. And suddenly, I was there, inside the bright waiting room, squinting against the onslaught of blinding light. I stumbled up to the counter. Even through my terror, I was dimly aware of the clerk's bored, unimpressed competence. Before I knew it, I was sitting across from a sergeant in a back room, jabbering wildly about dreams and fake passports, memory loss and child abuse, screaming girls in restaurants and laughing old men, blonde women in blue coats and great jeweled bulls with fangs like an ape. When I finished, the sergeant gave me a long, disbelieving stare. Then,
"What is this? Practice?"
She laughed heartily. My breath caught in my throat.
"That's good,"
she said.
"It ever comes to it, and they can't help their golden girl. You'll be fine."
She stood up and left the room. The door clunked shut. I stared at it blearily, trying to understand what had just happened. When it finally clicked into place, I shot up and ran to the door. I desperately pulled at the handle. It was locked, of course, locked as locked could be. I screamed and rattled and pounded the door. No one came. I thought of cameras and compounds, dark vans and filthy arenas, of being 12 years old and nameless, forgotten and lost, of being so worthless no one ever tried to find me. Finally, the door opened a fraction. I pawed at it frantically, trying to pull, then realized my body was blocking it. I pulled myself to my feet and stepped away, sobbing with relief as it swung open. Michael entered, disheveled and frantic. Before I could move, he was on me, hugging and patting me down tenderly, voice breaking as he tried to soothe me. Of course, I didn't want to go with him. Of course, I screamed and fought and begged for help. After tolerating it for a minute or so, the cops told me I had three choices. Go home with my husband, say hello to a 5150 hold, or trundle off to jail. So it turns out, I'm a vulnerable adult and Michael has complete legal authority over me. I have no autonomy. Even if I went to jail or a mental hospital, he'd be waiting to grab me the second I stepped outside. Since it was just a matter of time, I agreed to go home with him. He couldn't stop crying, even after we started driving. He was quiet, but obvious. Tears streamed down his face, and every breath hitched constantly. I was afraid he was going to wreck the car. At one of the numerous red lights, I finally said, I saw Thomas tonight.
Why would you do that?
He shouted. It wasn't on purpose.
Oh, fuck me, it wasn't on purpose. Why did you go to that store, huh?
He reached across and rattled the bag, spilling discs and drives across my feet.
Why did you get these? Why did you take them into the police station, Rachel? Do you even know what they are?
It's my body of work, I answered miserably.
Why do you have them? What are you hoping to see?
They knew me, I said. The people at the store.
Of course they fucking knew you!
How the hell is that possible? I screamed. He drew a deep breath, lost it to a sob, and inhaled again.
You're prolific.
His lip trembled, tears spilled down his cheeks, soaking his short, impossibly neat beard.
Famous.
He released a shoulder-racking sob.
They were meeting their favorite celebrity, Rachel.
My gorge rose. Except for his crying, we were silent for a long time. Finally, I said, Who is Thomas? His face twisted.
They found him with you when you were children. You were close, so they put you in a home together. Don't you remember?
I shook my head. He covered his eyes and I held still for another long while. When his hands finally dropped away, his face was blotchy, and for the very first time, there was no vitality to him, no youthful aspect or preternatural handsomeness. He just looked tired and old.
After they put you in the same home, he started hurting you, raping you. It's why you ran away, why you had so much trouble.
How did I meet you? I asked.
You are my patient. I fell in love with you.
You're a psychiatrist.
No, I lost my license for marrying you. I'm a PR now.
When did we get married?
5 years ago this May.
This is what I'd been waiting for. No! I shrieked triumphantly. He stared back, panic apparent in his face. I shuffled around in my computer bag and pulled out fistfuls of papers.
You married me when I was 18. I have proof. You have fake passports, fake names, fake licenses.
The sheer rawness of his pain was too much. I couldn't keep going, couldn't face it anymore, and I started to cry. The document slid from my hands and I leaned forward, resting my head against the dashboard. His hand quickly found mine. After a while, once I'd calmed down, he drew me close and hugged me fiercely.
Let me see the papers, okay?
His tears dampened my hair.
We'll look at them together.
We did, and it quickly became obvious that most of the pages were blank. Only the police reports were as I remembered. The photos, the records, the documents, gone, non-existent. Only pristine sheets of blank white paper. I don't think I've cried harder in my life. Michael held me while I wept, whispering senseless bits of comfort and stroking my hair. When I'd finally cried myself out, he drove me back to the house. It was still dark, but I imagined I could see the first hints of lightness in the sky. When we got inside, he pulled me to him, caressed my face, and kissed me gently. Wanted some semblance of intimacy and safety, and ultimately wanted him. So I took the lead. It was quick and satisfying, and we drifted to sleep as the morning sun broke over the canyon. I woke up yesterday afternoon. Michael was still asleep, arms slung loosely across my hip. His beating was rhythmic. I willed it to lull me back to sleep, but no luck. I was wide awake and unwilling to wake my exhausted husband just yet. I moved his arm carefully and slipped out of bed. After making sure he hadn't woken, I went downstairs to make coffee. When it was finished, I prepared two cups, one for me and one for him. I figured it was the least I could do. On my way back up, something caught my eye. Something in the downstairs hallway. Light. Maybe Michael had left the switch on last night. I detoured into the corridor, trying to make sense of what I was seeing. A pale bar of light spreading across the carpet. Daylight spilling through an open door. Michael's office door. I looked over my shoulder and listened. Nothing to see, nothing to hear. I counted to 60, then pushed open the door to the only unknown room in my perfect dollhouse. It is a big room, an enormous room, a room that seems far too big to fit in the house. It's also beautiful, hardwood floors and a sleek wooden ceiling with mahogany furniture. In the center of the room are four display stands. They are huge, easily long and wide enough to hold a human body. Two of them are empty. Two of them are, in fact, displaying bodies. Women's bodies. One looks just like me. Her hair is maybe a shade lighter, just a tiny bit more golden, but that's the only difference. Her skin is mottled white and purple, and she has a curiously twisted body. Her toes are yellowish and curled. Every time I look at them, I think of chicken claws. The second body, still as death but fresh as spring, is that of the woman with the blue coat. Her pale hair gleams like precious metal, and her skin is translucent. I can trace the paths of a dozen sapphire veins from across the room. They're both naked, except for necklaces. The blonde one is wearing a sapphire necklace I recognize from the photograph that was somehow disappeared. The one of her and Michael in the theater that does not exist. And the one that looks like me, the one who has been dead for a much longer time, is wearing the bull's head pendant. The cup slid from my hands. I was dimly aware of ceramic shattering on the floor. I backed away, reaching blindly for the door. The second I touched the solid wood, I heard his voice.
God damn it, Rachel.
The words held no venom, only tiredness and a hint of sorrow. I slammed the door in his face and locked it. Handle, deadbolt, padlock. There are three on the outside, three within. It has created quite the standoff.
When you're able to talk,
he said clearly, voice only slightly muffled.
I'll be in the kitchen.
After that, silence. I wondered if he'd left. Then,
please, don't be afraid.
I heard the tears in his voice, the abject misery. It was almost enough to make me melt. The floor creaked as he stepped away, and sure enough, I heard kitchen noises, cabinet doors and running water, the clink of silverware, and the distinctive hiss of the frying pan. In spite of everything, the scent of the food made my mouth water. Even now, the two corpses laid out 10 feet away, notwithstanding, the memory makes my stomach rumble. I've been in here for hours, all night. I'm hungry and thirsty and tired, and my bladder is killing me. There's a computer in here, but it's useless. I don't have anyone to email, no Facebook profile to update. I created an email to send a message to the sheriff's office, but I haven't heard anything. It's probably for the best. All I can think of is the laughing sergeant from last night, basically telling me, bravo. I tried to look myself up online, but found nothing. I made a Facebook account and started adding random people. Most rejected the request, a few accepted, but they're disappearing from my profile as quickly as I can add them. I don't know why. I got an angry message just now bitching me out for deleting them. All my pleas for help keep disappearing from my wall, too. I don't know what's happening. There's no cell phone in here, certainly no landline. The window faces the canyon, the wide open canyon where our closest neighbor is over a mile away. I've been watching the bodies. I'm afraid. I think my doppelganger is moving. Not by much, twitches and little shifts here and there. But the twitches and little shifts are things livid corpses should not be doing. You know, I really wish I'd gone to jail when I had the chance. It's 7:15. I've been in here since Saturday afternoon. The dead girls are moving. He's on the other side of the door, begging me to come out. I'm so tired. Whatever he does won't be worse than what's already happened. I'm going to unlock the door.